The following program is rated M for a mature audience. It contains coarse language and drug use.
As this is our final show, I thought what we might do tonight is get all nostalgic and maudlin. During the last few weeks, I've come to think of our show as a bit like a weekly Skype call with an elderly relative. I'm not sure which one of us is the elderly relative, but either way, I think it's fair to say the conversation's been a little one-sided. Anyway, it'll be some time before we catch up again, and hopefully by then we can be making jokes about fun things like $100 million sports rorts and allegedly forged documents that aren't being looked into. And we can all laugh again at the simple things, like Barnaby Joyce, or how our education minister sounds like he was homeschooled by Chad Morgan. Now, one of the downsides of the coronavirus has been that you can only get so many laughs out of it. But the Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, says...
There is a new normal here in Australia, and it's one that we now need to get used to and settle into for that haul over the next 6 months.
Ah, for the days of the old new normal, when we were just on fire. Sure, we had to stay indoors and wear face masks, but that was just because of the smoke haze. Anyway, only 6 more months and then things get back to how they were. New start, particularly. But there will be some changes that I fear might be hard to undo. Remember, Soylent Green was only supposed to last until they'd worked out a solution to the overpopulation problem. In other words, can we ever really put the genie back in the bottle? Yes, it's great the bottle is reusable, but wouldn't it be better to just pour any unwanted genie down the sink? I'm thinking here mainly of this.
Scott Morrison's preparing to ask more than 10 million Australians to share private data from their mobile phones to help track down unwitting COVID-19 sufferers who are spreading the disease.
Now, given Scott wouldn't even tell us where he was or that he was even out of the country when he went on holiday to Hawaii, that's a real turnaround for him. Now, the app is called...
Trace Together!
Yeah, so that sounds like fun, doesn't it? Especially if you say it like that. And how does it work?
Download Trace Together and help those around you to set it up.
Yes, and we're certainly going to need it if we all stand that close to each other. Dromella Bird, I understand that this app was originally developed to track George Christensen's overseas travel.
Well, Shaun, as the Prime Minister...
Scott Morrison.
..made very clear when he hinted the app could be compulsory and then said it wouldn't be. This is a voluntary scheme and we should all embrace it, or else.
It's a bit hard to be enthusiastic about it, though, when people we respect and admire, like Barnaby Joyce, refuse to download it. He says, I treasure the government knowing as little about me as possible.
Looks a lordy. After that interview he did on Seven and the one his ex-wife gave to the Women's Weekly and his book and all that dirt Shari Markson dug up on him and his own unfiltered rambling whenever anyone sticks a microphone in his face, what more is there to know? If it's that he's actually an alien, then that's something we've all long suspected.
And people are also a little worried that Stuart Robert's been put in charge of it.
Stuart's a very good friend of the Prime Minister. I mean, government... Services Minister.
Well, I don't want to be unfair to the guy, but he has got things wrong in the past.
When?
Well, when he mistakenly charged taxpayers $38,000 for his own internet usage, when he mistakenly accepted a $40,000 Rolex watch from a Chinese businessman, mistakenly breached ministerial standards by having shares in a trust linked to the mining company of a generous Liberal Party donor, when he mistakenly created the impression he was in China in an official capacity for a signing ceremony between a Chinese business and a mining company whose executive chairman was a generous Liberal Party donor, when he mistakenly made his 80-year-old father a company director, named his parents' home address as the company's principal place of business, which looked after tens of millions of dollars worth of government contracts, and he was responsible for robo-debt and in charge when the MyGov website crashed a few weeks back, which he then mistakenly blamed on a denial-of-service attack.
What's your point?
Well, look, here he is explaining how our information will be kept private.
Sounds pretty reasonable to me.
He goes on.
At no point does the Commonwealth get the data at all. And when the pandemic's done, I delete the app and all data from my phone. And then I, the minister, will blow away the national data store. And therefore, no data will be kept for individual citizens.
That sounds even more reasonable. None of the information goes to him. It's all on his phone. He deletes it when it's all over and then he blows it away, presumably with one of Bridget McKenzie's shotguns.
But I...
The takeaway here is that Scott's made it very clear this app is optional. If Australians decide not to share their private data, we'll just go and ask the Chinese government for it.
Well, thank you very much, Joe Miller, for coming in all season. And would you please accept, on behalf of Band as Hell, this?
Oh, I'm allergic.
Yeah, I know. Well, coming up in a moment, Andrew Bolt with sport.
Sport.
Thanks, Andrew. But right now it's time for Tosh Greenslade and a Wigan Glasses to explain how the billions in debt we've accumulated in the government's latest welfare bender will affect the future political landscape of this country. Tosh.
That's exactly right, Shaun. We have to look at the impact this debt has on the public consciousness as you would a poorly buttered slice of white bread. In the minds of voters, debt can cut two ways and be viewed as either bad, money government just pisses away, or good, money they more prudently piss into a jar so we can drink it later when we run out of water. Debt results from usually Labor, but now also Coalition, government spending, represented here by hundreds and thousands, or more accurately, hundreds and billions. Now, unfortunately for us, the butter, which represents years of accepted wisdom that Labor is bad with money, has only been applied to that one corner of the bread, so that when the fairy bread of reality has been jostled in the school lunchbox of time, the only debt that sticks to the public consciousness is the bad Labor sort, meaning the Coalition will get a free pass and we'll probably all still be hearing about pink bats for generations to come. Shaun.
Tosh Greenslade there, pushing the usual ABC agenda and sardonically pointing out how we instinctively apportion credit and blame for government fiscal policy. Speaking of finance, the Great Depression of 1929 was caused, as we all know, by the stock market crashing. So too, 1987's so-called Black Monday, leading to worldwide economic instability. But what we are facing now has been not the result of a crisis of faith in our own greed, but our business is being shut down by...
the bloody government.
And there's been a call that those who comprise...
the bloody government.
That is, the politicians, to take a pay cut as a gesture of solidarity to all those who've lost their jobs and are now living in reduced circumstances. As we know, New Zealand's PM and her team have taken a 20% pay cut and NRL teams are taking a whopping 75% pay cut. Mind you, they're not actually working, so fair enough. Australian politicians, though, aren't taking a pay cut, as Finance Minister Matthias Cormann explained.
And, I mean that's, you know, I would say right now the politicians are probably working harder than they ever have. This is the most intense period in my working life that I'm going through, and I think it's the same for most, if not all, of my colleagues.
Spokesman for Matthias Cormann, Darius Horsham. I assume that given that Matthias and his colleagues are working so much harder for the same money, that once this crisis is over, they could presumably go on a lower salary because they won't be doing as much.
Shaun, you are being a brown economic girly kitten on my leg. We are already paying people for doing nothing and businesses for their employees doing less than they was, if anything. Why does it follow that we would get less for actually getting off our lazy asses and going into work occasionally?
Well, it's a gesture.
No, this is a gesture. What's wrong with you people? We are trying to help you. McFly, hello, is there anybody home? I hope so, because you should be self-isolating. Anyway, all this is going to be gone in another 6 months.
Really? Our Treasurer, Josh Frydenberg, says...
we believe that the economic shock will be deeper, will be wider and will be longer.
Oh, what does he know? A year ago, he was predicting a budget surplus. He also said there'd be a big hole in the global economy. That's no big deal. The government will just pay people to fill that hole in. It's simple Keynesian economics.
What about foreign workers who aren't eligible for the government's JobKeeper or JobSeeker payments? Josh says...
if there's no work for them and then they can get back to their home country, then that is obviously an option for them.
Exactly. If you have to be unemployed, at least have the decency to do it in your own country rather than stinking up our Senderlink queues with your crazy cooking.
Yes, but why not offer them some support?
Our money is already busy, Shaun. I mean, sure. We all love it when the foreigners come over here to be underpaid in our bars, restaurants, cafes and orchards. But they aren't the ones who are going to have to pay back this $1 trillion debt, are they?
Well, why not? They could stay here. They could work and pay taxes.
Sure.
Yeah.
And if we're not paying them any benefits, it's not like they cost us anything. I'll speak to Josh.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Darius. And for coming in all season talking with me at a distance of actually less than 1.5 metres, please accept with our compliments Pete Evans, anti-COVID-19 biohealthiciser. Lose pounds if you buy it in England, 100% three-dimensional, and if you're not happy, cheer up. Well, coming up a bit later on, with personal protective gear becoming scarce and now being sold at grossly inflated prices, we look at latex gloves and see just how inflated they become. Also, now that Virgin has gone into administration, what will become of the government's plan for our airlines?
$165 million will go towards Qantas and Virgin to help keep these airlines afloat.
Yeah, I'm not sure converting them to watercraft was the best solution anyway, given how things are going with cruise ships these days. But first, Malcolm Turnbull. Now, as you know, I've always been a big fan. Smooth operator. So much so that I actually bought his book rather than download one illegally from the PMO's website. So let's have ourselves a little Wednesday night remaindered book club. Organising Malcolm Turnbull's book tour is a former Chief of Staff for Jackie Lambie, former speechwriter for Pauline Hanson, former policy wonk for Ricky Muir, and former night manager of the Pontevedra Ice and Bait Shop in Tasmania, Dolly Norman.
Hi, Shaun. Yeah, it's been a pretty busy 12 months, but you know what they say? When another door opens, one shuts because of a draft.
Yeah. Well, now, organising Malcolm's book tour must have been difficult because of the COVID-19 crisis. The coronavirus. The virus that's infected almost 3 million worldwide, put billions into lockdown, has closed all venues here and banned gatherings of over 2 people.
I thought things had been a bit quiet. We was up at the Sydney Opera House last week for a Q&A session and the crowd was pretty thin.
2 people?
Not even that. Malcolm didn't even turn up. I forgot to.
Still, the book's getting a lot of media coverage, particularly in The Australian, who can seem to write of nothing else, so that should be good for sales.
People love reading, Shaun. Not The Australian, obviously, but books. Mm-hmm. And you know what's been at the top of the bestseller list for this last year?
No, I don't.
A book. So I think that underlines my point. But if, like you say, that people are in the lockdown and they don't have anything to do and maybe they don't have Netflix or any board games, then why not buy Malcolm's book online? Assuming the NBN isn't playing up.
Yeah, well, that's his enduring legacy, isn't it?
I suggested he call it Mr. Fraudband.
Well, that's a good name.
With the subtitle, How I Dragged Australia into the 20th Century, and using this picture as the cover.
Mm-hmm. Oh, very nice.
I rang him and told him about it, but he wouldn't hear of it.
Didn't like it?
No, phone kept dropping out.
OK, well, finally, Dolly, a beautiful story in the memoir concerns another former Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd, and his bid to become UN Secretary-General, a bid that Malcolm Turnbull told Mr Rudd he wouldn't support because of his interpersonal and management skills.
I think Kevin took it pretty well. He only said that Malcolm was, and I quote, a piece of shit, before amending his view and saying that Malcolm was, and again, I quote, a little F dot dot king rat. Mm-hmm. And I think the word he was referring to there was...
Fucking.
Or possibly...
Fucking.
Alternatively...
Fucking.
Or maybe even...
Fucking.
Personally, I think Kevin would have made a great diplomat.
Agreed. Well, Dolly, thank you very much for coming in. And would you please accept tonight, with our compliments, this Blu-ray recording of the new Bunnings TV ad. Let's take a peek.
With the coronavirus running rampant, there's never been a better time to not come into Bunnings and just stay home.
Hand sanitizer, unavailable. COVID-19 vaccine, unavailable.
Finally get around to building that ventilator you've been meaning to. Please don't put me into the Bunnings logo. You've done it. Bunnings Warehouse.
Darius, are you still here?
No, the actor playing me has had to go to makeup and take all this off and change into another character for later on.
Oh, what a pity.
Is there anything I can help you with?
Well, I was hoping to ask you a question about Malcolm's book.
Shaun Matthias has already gone on the record saying that he has no time to read it. He is very busy not getting back to work until maybe next month.
Right. Well, he doesn't have to read it. There's an audio version read by Malcolm himself.
$44.75? It was bad enough hearing Malcolm say these things the first time around. There's no way Matthias is paying that much to hear him say them again.
Well, it wasn't going to be an awkward question. It wasn't about Matthias and how Malcolm said his treachery was the worst and most hurtful.
Well, I'm glad to hear it.
It was about how Malcolm said Peter Dutton was a narcissist and self-delusional.
Well, that makes perfect sense to me. If you're a narcissist, you're hardly going to be interested in deluding anyone else, are you? Now, Malcolm is quite right.
All right, well, thank you very much, Darius.
Fantastic.
And we'll be back right after this pre-recorded sketch, so don't go anywhere. It's not allowed.
It's an OK Night's viewing this Sunday at 8:30 with the plodding but inexplicably popular police procedural, Vera.
What we got, Aidan Love?
Where a long-standing mystery is solved as Vera finally discovers she's just Columbo with a Geordie accent, followed by another grisly beheading in Derbyshire with the Chief Superintendent Fulon dismemberments.
These puffins are greedy bastards, too lazy to build nests. They burrow underground like the vermin they are. Every winter, during the mating season, they abandon their colony and fly north to Southeast Asia for 2 months. This is less time than a certain unnamed politician spent there per year between 2015 and 2018.
Puffins that are better than George Christensen. Coming soon.
Welcome back. And the answer to our question, what is the collective noun for what Scott Morrison refers to as...
A team of Sherlock Holmeses.
...is a cummerbatch. A cummerbatch of Sherlock Holmeses. So congratulations, Wendy O'Herlihy of Flagstaff Hill, Adelaide, South Australia. You have won a bottle of Allan Cola Cola. Enjoy the ice-cold effervescence of your favourite ABC financial expert.
Mmm, that's nice.
Well, despite... Hello. Despite most of the world's inhabitants being confined to their homes, the NRL and the AFL are both looking to resume playing within the next 2 months. Head of indoor plant placement at the AFL, Tofu Croutons. This seems a high risk to me. Why the rush to resume the season?
Well, for one thing, Shaun, this lockdown is very tough on people. And I think footy fans in particular are looking for some relief from homeschooling and the kids and Skyping their parents and buying only 2 cases of beer, cider or premixes, 12 bottles of wine, no more than 10 litres of cask wine and 2 litres of spirit per visit to the bottle shop. I mean, a person can only take so much.
But given the outside gatherings are now limited to 2 people, meaning, I guess, 1 player per team, scores are going to be pretty low, aren't they?
Well, that's not going to happen, Shaun.
What do you mean? What about social distancing?
Shaun, that's for ordinary people. And the AFL are not ordinary people. We walk amongst you, yes, but we are gods. Fashioned in the likeness of mortals, but deity made flesh nonetheless.
Yes, but this is an unprecedented national crisis.
I know. Tragically, we're still losing 9 games every week, and that number is not going down. And until someone comes up with a vaccine, most likely Essendon, given their history, the only way to get it down is by testing our players against each other in the heat of battle.
Well, thanks very much, Tofu. Tofu Croutons there, talking about sport. Well, to offensiveness now and...
Nazi and Chinese flags have been hoisted atop a phone tower in the Goulburn Valley with concerns it could be connected to a baseless conspiracy theory about 5G.
The conspiracy theory being that the 5G network is spreading the coronavirus, presumably by transmitting radio waves carrying infected droplets up our noses. Now, I get the presence of the Chinese flag. That's just common or garden racism. But the swastika? What's the connection between Nazis and 5G? I mean, yes, they were unhappy with poor mobile phone coverage back then, but that was 3G. They were the Third Reich, not the Fifth. Come on, people. Being a lunatic doesn't excuse you from doing your research. In this time of rapidly changing mores, we have to ask if the implied social contract we have between all of us is worth the paper it's not printed on. We're relying more and more on our institutions, like the justice system, a system made up of 2 separate but equally important groups, the police, who fine people for, say, sitting together in the park, and the other police, who later revoke that fine and apologise. New South Wales Police Liaison Cadet Sammy Twerb, it's a delicate, as the French would say, balance.
Oh, very much so, Shaun. Mm. I always say that far from our handgun or riot shields or ballistic engineered armoured response counter-attack trucks, it is our discretion that is our most powerful weapon. And like any weapon, its true power lies in knowing when to use it. It's very tempting, of course, to rush into a situation, all discretion's blazing, apologising and revoking fines left, right and centre, but our officers have been showing commendable restraint.
I think people would like some clarity, though. For example, the woman who was fined $1,600 for posting a holiday snap from 2019 on her Facebook, or the man who was fined $1,600 for walking 200 metres from his house to go paddleboarding.
Yes, it was inappropriate to issue penalty notices on both of those counts.
On both those what?
Look, Shaun, as the Deputy Commissioner has said, we are human and we will make mistakes.
So these kinds of mistakes could be avoided if you had some sort of non-human police officer that didn't make mistakes?
Yes, some sort of Robocop, like from that movie, Inspector Gadget 2.
Well, in the case of the 2019 Facebook photo, the woman had simply posted it as a memory. Surely the police can tell the difference between things happening now and things that are just memories.
You've obviously not watched True Detective, Shaun. Seriously hard to follow that. I think when it's a memory, the screen should go all squiggly and it should be harp glissandos. Plus, have you seen the new Facebook layout? That is the real crime.
Yeah, I looked at it yesterday. Mm-hmm. Coming up, it's not all doom and gloom, with internetthingnews.com.au reporting that some businesses are actually thriving as a result of the coronavirus, with online ukulele store Ukulele Mate increasing sales by 700%, and divorce inquiries at Reed Family Lawyers going through the roof. I assume those two things are directly related. But right now it's time for Leonardo DiCaprio, Donald Trump and Angela Merkel with sport.
Sport.
Of course, ever since Eve pointed out Adam's nakedness and made him eat an apple, it's been human nature to crave physical intimacy. And if we can't get it in a brothel, the back alley of a pub or a music festival, we might seek it in the home where we're forced to stay with our partners. Because of this, though...
There's speculation we're heading for another baby boom.
Yes, with nothing to do, people are having sexual intercourse, and this regrettably leads to children. Doesn't it, Australian Bureau of Statistics projection analyst Mitsubishi Pajero Sport?
Not so regrettably, Shaun, because we're going to need a lot of people in this next generation to pay off our massive government debt. And we should all, I think, be getting our leg over for the sake of the future.
You think elderly Australians are up to the task?
If they want us to keep paying for their franking credit, sure. And if we could all make foreign babies too, that would be helpful, because when they grow up, they can work here on a visa and pay taxes, but we won't have to support them with free daycare or educate them while they're growing up, so it's all profit.
How do we make foreign babies?
In the usual way, just not on Australian soil. There's a lot of empty cruise ships around at the moment. People love cruisers, particularly the elderly. And we could round them up, force them on board, tow them out to international waters, switch their usual medication for Viagra, turn out the lights and, hey presto, 20 years later, a slave army of foreign workers to build our pyramids or whatever infrastructure projects we've got going on to get us out of our trillion-dollar black hole.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Mitsubishi Pajero Sport. You're right for later, for the thing?
Yes.
Now, I spoke earlier in the show of my admiration for Malcolm Turnbull. Smooth operator. But I want to make it clear that the respect and awe in which I held Malcolm never got in the way of me calling him to account in my role as a fake news host. You might remember our searing expose a few years back on a peculiar tic of Malcolm's where he goes up on his tippy toes.
And that is not just a list of statistics. Not from a career in politics. And I'm very happy to talk about climate change.
But it's kind of nice to mark the release of Malcolm's memoir, which incidentally is called A Bigger Picture, which I believe is what he always wanted in the party room. Several former colleagues are paying homage to their former leader as a sort of tribute act to help promote the book. Here's former Treasurer Scott Morrison.
But if it weren't for the JobKeeper program, we would have seen that rate of unemployment.
Here's former Industry, Innovation and Science Minister Greg Hunt.
On the flight to make sure that all the protocols are followed and finally to ensure that...
And former Minister for the seemingly mutually exclusive departments of Environment and Energy, Josh Frydenberg.
We have no plans to change the GST.
And to take us to the break, some Booker T and the MGs.
Excuse me. Shaun. I say Shaun. Hey.
Oh, yes, sorry, question from Dave Graney there. Yes, Dave. Yes, I think I'll take that as a comment.
With winter just around the corner.
Here's some jobs you might want to get up to this weekend.
Roses add beauty, colour and structure to a garden, but the thorns really hurt, so I pull them up and burn them. Plant potatoes of most varieties now, or alternatively, build a meth lab. And dead animals, such as camels, apes or bears, should be buried in a sunny, sheltered position.
These mice are about to shit themselves.
That's Shaun Micallef's Very Surprised Rodents, weekdays at Pi.
Welcome back. Well, our Health Minister, Greg Hunt, there is no way you have found a picture or anything like that. Oh, fair enough. Anyway, Greg has issued a call-out to retired medical workers to join the fight against coronavirus, a time to rely on, I think, the wisdom of the elders.
Hand kneaded dough?
No, thank you.
Are you sure?
Yes.
All righty.
Bill, tell me, you were an orderly in the Korean War.
Yes, I was. Yes, we had a MASH unit and we're always getting up to some sort of hijinks or other.
Was it as enjoyable as the TV series?
Well, I'm not sure which one you're referring to, but if it's Bachelor in Paradise, then no, not at all. In fact, the Korean War was far more enjoyable to sit through, particularly if you're in pain. But my job was mainly to uncrate the penicillin that our boys needed to fight off the raging gonorrhea they'd gotten in...
Pangdong.
Well, there's no need to be that specific.
How do you feel, Bill, about pulling on the scrubs again?
Well, in a sense, one never really takes them off, does one? I mean, yes, the doctors and nurses might say that's unhygienic, but I believe it's good for building up the antibodies and the cockroachy bodies.
Well, aren't you concerned about the lack of personal protective equipment for medical staff?
Not at all. I believe a mask can be worn at least four times, like underwear.
Forwards, backwards, inside out forwards and inside out backwards.
Yes, and under your trousers at all times, obviously.
Well, on behalf of Australia, Bill, thank you for answering the call.
Oh, we can go through the voicemail. Come with me, I want to show you something.
Oh, I'd be delighted.
All right. Bim-bala-bala-bala-bim-bam-boo. They'll edit this bit out, obviously. Unless they're running under this week, of course. Well, although they don't tend to pad things out just for the sake of it, do they?
Get on with it.
Yes, all right. Now, Francis, you never know when a complete lockdown might come into effect and you won't be able to go out and buy something from the shops. That's why I recommend stocking up on lots and lots of sushi, soft cheeses, unpasteurised fresh milk, pastries, mints, ice cubes and, of course, very expensive Italian hiking boots, 10 pairs at least. Now, roll up your sleeve.
Is this going to hurt?
Oh, yes. It's a very old needle. But once the heroin kicks in, you won't care. Ah, there we go. Oh, yeah. Now you're talking. Oh, yeah. Cooking with gas. Yeah. Ah. Oh, the spirals and the colours.
Well, next up, Stephen Fry with...
Sport.
But not coming up because we've run out of season.
Unnecessary air travel... and water in Great Barrier Reef now hot enough to cook toast.
Well, that's all for this season, folks. We're not doing a big musical finale because we're not allowed to have any dancers come in and we're not actually good enough to do it ourselves. And we're back mid-year anyway, which means you only have to wait until end of September for a big proper song and dance number and not the bit of rubbish we'd end up doing on our own. Good night.
Do you remember the 21st night of September? Love was changing the minds of pretenders while chasing the clouds away. Our hearts were ringing in the key that our souls were singing as we danced in the night. Remember how the stars stole the night away.
We're not due to start our next season until August, so if we do go on at all, our end-of-season finale will actually be in October.
Fuck!
Giant baby.
Next on ABC and iView, is winning really everything? Gold medalists answer the hard questions on You Can't Ask That. Then, Planet America.
It feels good.
The best entertainment is yours to stream free on iView.
Come on in, people.
Collections of the biggest titles.
With complete series of dramas.
Comedies.
Docos.
True crime.
And lifestyle programs.
Cheers. It feels
good. See you then, Australia. Like
I knew it would. iView, yours to stream.
So you don't think about her anymore?
I dealt with it.
Huh? She's back, Eve, and she's working.
Bonjour! Du bleu, du rouge.
Eve, she's alive.
Du blanc.
It's not possible.
Du noir.
I have Kenny's phone. I need to know what happened.
You know when a bullet has been through you, it leaves something behind.
War management sucks.
The new season of Killing Eve, streaming now on iView.
Coming up on Planet America, protesters take to the streets demanding an end to the lockdown, but who gets to decide?
Plus, we turn to Sweden, who have kept things open during this crisis. Have they got rocks set in their heads?
Oh, dear. And Trump is behind in the polls. Can he catch up?
All that and more right after You Can't Ask That.